Paulism is a Luciferian cult contained within the Beatles, where Paul McCartney is worshipped and adored by fans, either knowingly or unknowingly, as the graven Christ figure who died and was resurrected and came back to life in the person of William Shepherd, also known as Billy Shears. McCartney's arched eyebrow represents the Eye of Ra or the Eye of Horus, which is also known as the All-Seeing Eye. Paulism was created by the Pyramid of Power to permanently transform the minds of the masses by shifting the ethos of traditional lifestyles and beliefs to a new paradigm of one-world thinking and acceptance. People who worship the Beatles, and in particular Paul McCartney, are adherents to Paulism, whether they know it or not. The sheer magnitude of the number of people worshiping the Beatles makes the cult of Paulism a very powerful force in implementing the philosophy and ideology of Luciferianism, which is the spiritual belief system of the controllers. Aleister Crowley's religion of Thelema aligns with the tenets of Luciferianism, and this is why Crowley's influence is very prominent throughout the music and entertainment industry. This is also why the Beatles are constantly revered by artists and entertainers as a source of inspiration. Their homage transcends the Beatles, who are acting as conduits to a higher power, with that higher power being Lucifer. Here's an excerpt of an interview Bob Dylan did with Rolling Stone magazine back in 2007. I found the clip interesting because when asked about George Harrison, Dylan pauses and appears to struggle to come up with a compliment regarding George. Then when he discusses Lennon and McCartney, he tells us they were fantastic singers. He doesn't say songwriters or musicians. He also initially uses the past tense when referring to Paul McCartney singing, and then corrects himself and says was and still is, with is being the current tense referring to Billy. Bob then proceeds to tell us how he is in awe of Billy, who plays the resurrected Christ figure, as he displays his reverence to the son of the magician, the Beatles, and thus Luciferianism. Let's take a listen.
Talk about musicians, you know, maybe one in a thousand are worth listening to.
In terms of what they have to say.
Yeah, in terms of what they have to say, in terms of what they're putting forth, in terms of the world they're involved in, in terms of moving you from here to there. There's not many musicians capable of that.
In terms of people relatively your contemporaries, just comment on like, for instance, Neil Young.
Neil?
What do you think of Neil? He's one of those.
Neil is very sincere, if nothing else. I mean, he's sincere, and he's got God-gift talent, you know, with that voice of his and a melodic strain that runs through absolutely everything he does. I mean, he can be at his most thrashy, but it's still going to be elevated by some melody. Mm-hmm. You know, Neil's the only one who does that. There's nobody in his category.
Mm-hmm. What do you tell me about George Harrison and his music?
George got stuck, you know, with being the Beatle that had to fight to get songs on records because of Lennon and McCartney. Well, you know, who wouldn't get stuck? Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, if George had had his own group and was writing his own songs back then, he'd have been probably just, you know, just as big as anybody. George had uncanny ability to just play chords and of just that didn't seem to be connected in any kind of way. And come up with a melody and a song. I mean, I don't know anybody else who could do that either, you know. I mean, what can I tell you?
We look back on him like incredibly tasteful guitar player and inventive. And
totally.
Different than anybody
totally.
Else.
Totally.
Every single thing he did was a new one, a new...
Yeah, he was from that old line of playing where, you know, every note... Was a note to be counted.
Mm-hmm. How close were you to him? Very close, right?
Yeah.
What was the nature of your friendship?
Well, we've known each other since the old days, really. I knew the Beatles really early on. All of them.
What was your relationship with John Lennon like? Somewhat competitive. He was a competitive kind of
guy. Yeah.
God.
Only in a certain to a certain extent, but not really. Him and McCartney both really. I mean, they were fantastic singers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, Lennon to this day. I mean, it's hard to find a better singer than Lennon was, or than McCartney
mm-hmm.
was and still is. I mean, I'm in awe of McCartney. He's about the only one that I am in awe of, but I'm in awe of him. I mean, he can do it all, and he's never let up. You know, he's got the gift for melody. He's got the rhythm. He can play any instrument. He can scream and shout and as good as anybody, and he can sing a ballad as good as anybody. Mm-hmm. You know, so. And his melodies are you know effortless. That's what you have mm-hmm. to be in awe. I'm in awe of him. It was just because he's just so damn effortless. Mm-hmm. I mean, I just wish he'd quit. You know, he's like, it just anything comes out of his mouth is just a frame and a melody. You know?
Now let's flash back to 2004 and Dylan's 60 Minutes interview with Ed Bradley, where he talks about the bargain he made with the chief commander, or Lucifer.
Why do you still do it? Why are you still out here?
Well, it goes back to the destiny thing. I mean, I made a bargain with it, you know, a long time ago, and I'm holding up my end.
What was your bargain?
To get where I am now.
Should I ask who you made the bargain with?
with the chief commander.
On this earth?
On this earth and then in a world we can't see.
You ever look at music that you've written and look back at it and say, whoa, that mm-hmm. surprised me?
I used to. I don't do that anymore. I don't know how I got to write those songs.
What do you mean you don't know how?
Well, those early songs were like almost magically written. Darkness at the break of noon, shadows even the silver spoon, a handmade blade, a child's balloon.
Eclipses both the sun and moon to understand you knew too soon. There's no sense in trying.
This Dylan classic, It's All Right, Ma, was written in 1964.
Piece the hollow horn, plays wasted words, proves to warn that he not busy being born is busy dying.
Well, try to sit down and write something like that. There's a magic to that, and it's not Siegfried and Roy kind of magic. You know, it's a different kind of a penetrating magic. And, you know, I did it at one time.
You don't think you can do it today?
Mm-mm.
Does that disappoint you?
Well, you can't do something forever, and I did it once, and I can do other things now, but I can't do that.
I expect more, you know. Maybe I expect too much from people, you know. But I expect more. You know? But I haven't been a Dylan follower since he stopped rocking, you know. I like Rolling Stone and a few things he did then, you know. I like a few things he did in the early days, but the rest of it's just like, you know, McCartney or something, you know. It's no different, you know. It's a myth.
Yeah, all of you hit the G on the way down to F. One, two, one, two, three, four.
So Sergeant Pepper took you by surprise.
cut.